Are you sometimes afraid of the unknown? Does something happen to you or you encounter something that puts fear in your life that you suddenly go, oh my goodness, like I know that my brain is telling me everything's okay, but I'm actually really scared, I'm really worried. I went camping one time that I need a break, I need to relax, and I took my two dogs with me. And I went up to an area that's really extreme camping. I'm the guy, I don't want the little like RV spots, I wanna go camp in the middle of nowhere. And I've got my campfire, I'm hanging out, it starts getting dark. And then suddenly out of the woods, I hear, aah! And I'm like, what was that? The most horrifying, scary sound I think I've ever heard. And it's echoing across the lake, across these woods that I'm in. And then I hear another one from over there, aah! Like the mournful, like siren ghost sound you hear in the movies. That's what I was hearing. And my dogs are freaking out. Their hair is up and they're growling. And that of course doesn't help my anxiety level. And I go, this has to be something natural. This has to be something that is real. However, what is it? The unknown I was scared of, I was fearful of. Found out later it's actually season for elk when they're kind of looking for a mate. And that's their mating call, this horrible, scary, a sound that was echoing out over the trees around my campsite. But that's the thing is, when we don't know what something is or what it involves, it can put great fear inside of us. And so that's what we're gonna be tackling today, is how do we approach and deal with, as believers and walking out our faith, running into the unknown. Welcome to church.
There's a table that you've prepared for me in the presence of my enemies. It's your body and your blood you shed for me. This is how I fight my battles. There's a table you've prepared for me in the presence of my enemy. It's your body and your blood you shed for me. This is how I fight my battle.
Fight my battles.
like I'm surrounded, but I'm surrounded by you. It may look like I'm surrounded, but I'm surrounded by you. It may look like I'm surrounded, but I'm surrounded by you. It may look like I'm surrounded, but I'm surrounded by you.
Pure Heart family, I'm starting my family vacation, so I'm not going to be with you this weekend, but I'm so excited about this weekend's message. Pastor Heath is going to be teaching, and he's going to be dealing with a topic that we all need to hear about, that we all deal with. Hey.
Hey, Dan.
Hey.
Hey.
Oh, Heath.
I'm sorry, I didn't mean to startle you.
Hey.
I'll tell you what.
Just getting ready to introduce you.
This studio gets really, really dark, but it does make me think of this. Have you ever been scared of the dark?
No.
Really? Not like when you were little?
No.
Or?
I don't think so.
Or like now?
I'm good.
Really?
Well, yeah.
Well, good. Well, actually, so this week, we're actually going to be talking about being afraid of the dark, but not in the way that you and I think. We're talking about it in life. A lot of times when the world gets dark around us, are we actually scared of that darkness, or are we pressing into it?
That'll be good. So,
yeah.
I could probably benefit from that.
Very.
I mean, not that I'm scared of the dark. But
no, I mean, I assume so, that you're fine, right?
I mean, so,
wait, just, no. You are fine, right?
I'm good.
Okay.
Come on, man. It's
great.
Dark. I'm not a kid.
Yeah, totally.
Yeah.
That's what I need to hear.
Yeah, that's good. Heath? Heath? Matt? Guys? Guys? Man, I really need a vacation.
I remember when I was little and laying in bed at night, eyes wide open in the pitch black, listening to every single creak and random noise. And even though I was scared of the possibility of something under the bed just waiting to get me, I operated from this bizarre night logic. Now, I know it doesn't make any sense, but many of you did the exact same thing. And it was this: anything that wasn't covered by the blanket was fair game to monsters, right? You remember that. And not only did we know this was the rule, but we also knew the monsters knew this was the rule too. Now, of course, did it make any sense? Absolutely not. But it didn't stop me from pulling that blanket over my head and fully insulating myself from everything that scared me in that terrifying room. Because you see, when the monster would walk up to the bed, he'd be forced to be like, dang it, he's under the blanket. Guess I'm gonna have to try again tomorrow. You see, what's even weirder is that I usually have a small, like, key flashlight with me. But instead of using it on the room, instead of looking around with it to get rid of the dark I was terrified of, I'd actually use it to light up my insulated little igloo of a blanket on my bed. There I'd be, all tucked in my little blanket bubble, maybe sometimes with a book, completely safe and completely hidden. Now, what's funny is that no matter how certain I was that there was nothing to be scared about during the day or when all the lights were on, as soon as the dark settled in, armed with my keychain flashlight, my fear so overtook my logic that I created an entirely new reality to make sure I was safe and secure. Sure, it didn't match actual reality at all, but it didn't seem to matter. Not only did I make it make sense, but everything seemed to play by the rules that I had conjured up. And you know what? Many of you did the exact same thing. Thank goodness we finally grew out of that. Or did we? You see, in the book of Matthew, Jesus takes a minute to make what seems like it should be a very obvious point. In Matthew 5, verses 14 through 17, he says this, "You are the light of the world, like a city on a hilltop that can't be hidden. You see, no one lights a lamp and then puts it under a basket. Instead, a lamp is placed on a stand where it gives light to everyone in the house. In the same way, let your good deeds shine out for all to see so that everyone will praise your Father in heaven." What he's saying is, light is not intended to be hidden. It's not intended to be insulated, kept in a safe and sometimes imaginary or made-up space. It's intended to be seen, to radiate out. It exists to help others who are without it. It's not intended to torch them or blind them or shame them, and it was never intended to be withheld. You see, but as believers, we have a tendency to take our little keychain flashlight and slowly recede into the safety of that blanket. The unfortunate reality is this. Most of us are okay with being a light, as long as we're in a well-lit room, because we're still afraid of the dark. Now, that fear can sometimes come out as anger, frustration, and often, just like with the monsters, we create new rules and realities that we have convinced ourselves make sense in the dark to keep us safe. But I need you to get this. That's not where we want to be, because it's not where we're called to be. A great example of this is Moses, his brother Aaron, and a crazy story in the book of Numbers. Let's take a look. So in Numbers 16, here's the scenario. The children of Israel were wandering around in the desert, and over the years, they had gotten more and more unsettled. They were getting anxious. They were starting to question everything that Moses and Aaron did, because what should have been a short journey was now turning into years and years of wandering. And so there was a group of people that were getting angrier and angrier with Moses and Aaron. They were telling them things like, you know what? You shouldn't be leading us. You know what? I don't want to adhere to your rules. You know, I can hear from God on my own too. I don't have to adhere to your version of what you think God wants us to do. And so they started grumbling and complaining and actually reinventing the past. They started talking about Egypt as if it was this luxury place and resort instead of this horrible place of slavery. They started rewriting the narrative and wanted to get rid of Moses and Aaron. And so in this moment, this uproar gets to God, and God's like, you know what? I'm done. I'm gonna allow this plague to come through and wipe out all of Israel. But in that moment, Moses and Aaron were not having it. And so this is how this plays out. And Matt, can you come up here?
Yeah.
So I need you to be Aaron, okay?
Okay.
So Moses is talking to Aaron, and he's like, okay, we need to take a censer. Now, a censer is this thing that like holds like coals from the altar.
Okay, like a cup kind of thing?
Yeah.
Almost like
do we have
a chalice?
Something that we can use for that?
I got something.
Cool.
A few moments later.
So we'd have this would be a censer or whatever. He might have it on a rope or something, but he puts coals from the altar and incense, and then it's on, so it's kind of like on fire, you know, okay. Or whatever, burning this. I don't know if we have anything that could stimulate.
That one will take a second longer. Give me one second.
If you can just find some fire somewhere in the studio, that would be awesome.
6.5 hours later.
Oh, that's perfect. It's warm.
Yeah. Warming.
That's great. So Moses and Aaron know that they have to take this censer. And what it would do is it would purify and cleanse and stop the plague. And so I can almost imagine that whole scenario going out, because here's Moses knowing that the censer has to be taken right into where people are dying. Because you can almost imagine this wall of plague, this cloud sweeping across the people of Israel. And everywhere that it touches, people are falling over dead, left and right. And Moses and Aaron going, we need to take this censer and we need to get as far into that death as possible in order to stop the plague.
Yeah, and you go, any volunteers?
Yeah, and Moses is going, hey, you know what? Leadership is hard and it forces us to make very tough decisions. And in that moment, Moses had to stand up and go, I know what needs to be done. So when you get out there, go ahead and let me know how it turns out.
I'm gonna hold my breath.
Yeah. And you're going, wait a minute, Moses, why are you bailing on this task? Why are you sending Aaron out? We'll get back to that. But I want you to know is this. In Numbers 16, starting in verse 47, this is how this plays out. Aaron did as Moses told him and ran out among the people. The plague had already begun to strike down the people, but Aaron burned the incense and purified the people. And here's the passage I want you to get. He stood between the dead and the living, and the plague stopped. Imagine that. Aaron ran straight on into the dark. Not only that, in the middle of people that had meant him harm, that had it out for him, crowds that had said that Aaron and Moses had no business forcing their views on them, that wanted leadership that took them where they wanted to go. People that had rewritten history, like I said, and painted the horrors of slavery into a land flowing with prosperity and health. He ran into a plague cloud, into death itself, into a room full of monsters. And what's interesting is this. In the process of doing that, he didn't ridicule the people he was running to save. You didn't see him smack them with the coals and incense. He didn't argue with them. He didn't post passive-aggressive memes on their social media and make sure they knew they had been wrong and that he was right. He didn't also hand-pick the purified. They didn't have to say they were sorry first or change their views prior. They didn't need to flip their vote or be better. He wasn't bashing their failures or outlining how other churches missed the mark. He didn't waste energy on any of that. Because Aaron's mission was simple and profound. He was there to save as many as he could, period. So why him? Why did he go do this instead of Moses? Why did this responsibility fall to him? And it's actually pretty simple. It was because Aaron had the role of a priest. And the role of a priest was actually to make atonement for people. He stood in the gap, as the phrase is, which means that he interceded to God on behalf of the people. His mission, his goal was to do exactly that, to stand up and be the one who stood up for the people. It was his role. It was his mission. And the thing that really stands out to me is this. In that passage, it says Aaron ran. And I'll tell you what, Aaron was not a young, spry guy at that point. He was an older man. Imagine how much drive and passion was in him to see him take off and run right into the plague that was killing people. That mission drove him. It's amazing how many attributes of God there are. In the Bible, the first thing we discover about God is that he creates. It's actually the very first line. There are so many ways that each of us individually connect with who God is. In one moment, you're overwhelmed by his grace, in awe of his power, maybe inspired by his creativity, humbled by his mercy, or you feel embraced by his love. And we know that. One of the things we know about God is that he is love. We read about it, we sing about it, we experience it. But get this, everything that you know about God is known because of one reason. We know everything that we know about God because God is missional. We know all of these things because of the mission of God. He pursued you. He reached out to you. When you were actually his enemy, his mission became to bring you back to him, to restore his creation. Everything you have learned about God, all of it, you have learned because of the mission of God. And what we sometimes miss is that his mission has become our mission. And we know this from different passages of scripture, flat out says it. In John 20, verse 21, after Jesus had risen from the grave, he actually told his disciples, he said, "Peace be with you. As the Father has sent me, so I am sending you." And in Acts, before Jesus ascended back into heaven, one of the last things he told the disciples before he left, and if it's one of the last things, you know the weight of it. It was so important. He wanted to communicate something of value to his disciples. As they're walking toward the hill where Jesus was going to ascend, he said this. When the apostles were with Jesus, they kept asking him, "Lord, has the time come for you to free Israel and restore our kingdom?" And his response to them in verse 7 was this. He said, "The Father alone has the authority to set those dates and times, and they're not for you to know." Basically, he's saying, wrong question, guys. I don't want to spend too much time on that. It's not about the current political landscape. It's not about knowing the future. It's not about any of those details. I want to get down to what I am communicating directly to you guys. And this is what's important. He goes on, "You will receive power when the Holy Spirit comes upon you." To what end? He's about to tell you. He said, "And you will be my witnesses, telling people about me everywhere, in Jerusalem, throughout Judea, in Samaria, and to the ends of the earth." So when Jesus tells us, "You're the light of the world," he is flat out telling us that our mission is not to withdraw and stay safe. He's in fact calling us to embrace his mission. And this is the mission I want you to get. Being light in the darkness is our mission. We know this. The darkness can be intimidating, but the mission doesn't stop. We can forget the fact that darkness is simply the absence of light. And you know how to push back the dark? Show up. But we constantly are talking ourselves out of just doing exactly that, showing up. I want to touch on three ways that we do that. Reasons why we don't show up. Number one, because it's dark and difficult. In Arizona, years ago, they created a thing called the biosphere. And in this biosphere, they had different types of environments that they cultivated over the years in a completely shut out environment where it was completely shut out from the outside world. And in each of these little areas, in each of these little cultures, environments, they would grow plants, they would raise animals, all these different things. And in their forest environment, they grew trees. But what they found was interesting is that over the years, just randomly, these trees would suddenly just fall over. The trees would just snap and break and fall over, and they couldn't understand why. But the scientists soon learned that the fact that they were falling over because there was no wind in the biosphere. And here's what we need to get. The resistance that we face is actually things that help us grow. When we don't have resistance, when we don't have the wind, we end up becoming brittle and set in our ways, and we break easily. Just because something is hard, because something is difficult, we need to lean in even more. We cannot avoid things because they're dark and difficult. My dog Jovi, and I think we got a picture of her, is a golden retriever. And just out of curiosity, do you know why they're called retrievers? It's not a trick question. They're called retrievers because they retrieve. That's how they're bred. That's what they do. So you throw something, they will go retrieve it and bring it back. If you're hunting, they will be the ones to retrieve the game that you shot. And so that is built into their DNA. That's their role. It's who they are. As a golden retriever, you know that if you throw a toy, they're going to go run and grab it and bring it back. Except for this, my dog Jovi is scared of a lot of things. Actually, Jovi is scared of almost everything. Okay. She's scared of large boxes. She's scared of shadows. She's scared of strangers. She's scared of the front door. She's also scared of the dark. And what's interesting is that when we're playing fetch in the house, if I'm throwing a toy back and forth, she's fine running and going getting it. She'll come back, bring me the toy. I'll throw it again. She books over to go get it until I throw it in the front room. Because then I'll throw it in the front room. The lights are off and she goes right up to that room and is just like, hits the brakes. She's like, "It's in there." I'm like, "Okay, Jovi, go get the toy. Go get the toy." She's like, "I'm not going in there." "Jovi, get the toy. There's nothing in there." Well, you should have thought about that before you threw it. But oftentimes, our fears are ridiculous and they keep us from doing the things that we're actually geared to do. and will push back and say, I can't, it's too dark. We need to pull back. The church is being persecuted, don't you see? We're facing an onslaught of evil agendas. Jesus must be coming back. It's the end of days. And first off, I just want you to know, our corner of the world is not the center of it. God is doing amazing things in the lives of people all around the globe. But secondly, looking at our church history, I am pretty sure when you look at all the faced years of physical persecution, horrendous torture, vicious martyrdom, and somehow by the grace of God, we made it through, I will tell you this, we can somehow survive the terrible darkness of agendas because they don't scare God and they don't change our mission. Number two, another way that we don't show up, because of what people think. On August 24, 2006, scientists formally announced that after years of inclusion, Pluto was no longer an official planet. They kicked him off the list. You know what? Everyone took it pretty hard, especially Pluto. You see, being a planet is really difficult, so I've heard. And he basically decided he had had enough. For quite a while, he just posted sarcastic comments on other planets' posts. He boycotted the scientific journal. He actually took up smoking and went into hiding. You know, wait, that's, no, of course that didn't happen. Pluto did this. He kept doing what Pluto had been doing. Flying through space, orbiting the sun, and occasionally posing for pictures. But you see, many of you go, well, that's stupid. Pluto's this rock out in space. It doesn't have any feelings. Well, first off, ouch. Secondly, Pluto also doesn't have the hope that we have or the faith that we're called to have. So why are we still stressing about what other people think? The third way we don't show up, because we think they don't deserve it. So I have three boys, and you guys have probably seen pictures of them, but I've got more pictures of them because everybody that talks on this that basically shows pictures of their kids. So I'm gonna do that too. You see, growing up, I had my boys memorize a brother's saying. When I would ask, what do brothers do? Anytime they'd have a disagreement or arguing or whatever, I'd say, what do brothers do? And they would say, brothers look out for each other. They take care of each other. They love each other. You know, notice in that saying, I never said if you agree with everything they do or if they act just like you. You see, when it comes to showing up, we are responsible for what God has called us to do. And that's not dependent on how much we feel someone deserves it or how we think others will respond to it. And you'll say, but you don't understand. They are so messed up. Yes, we are. We have to stop rewriting the gospel into a story where our messiness is cleaner than everyone else's. We've gotten pretty good at thinking that we're the last ones through the gate. But Paul says this in Romans 5, verse 10, for since our friendship with God was restored by the death of his son, while we were still his enemies, we will certainly be saved through the life of his son. You see, that opportunity exists for everyone. Aaron ran, even though the people he was running to were bad-mouthing him, taunting him, telling him he was not right, that their way was just as good, that he and Moses had no right to tell them what to do or how to live, and they wanted to get rid of Moses and Aaron altogether, and yet Aaron still ran to them. Most of us would rather get even. And the question we all need to ask is this: do we want to be an example to or make an example of? But again, why is this our job? You know, isn't that reserved for people like pastors or people with a very specific set of skills? I mean, Heath, you said it yourself, Aaron was a priest. I mean, I like the idea of being a light as long as I'm surrounded by a lot of other lights. You see, it's not my gifting to go light up the dark like you're talking about. I'm not an evangelist. In fact, honestly, if I could hunker down and not interact with another secular heathen or whatever you call them again, maybe never see another opposing political ad or avoid the messy lives of neighbors. Ooh, if I could remove all of the posts on social media I disagree with. And you know what'd be cool? If I could work with only Christians, go straight to church and then straight back home each week, that's the dream. Being the line between the living and the dead, it just ain't who I am. I ain't him. I'm not that person. But who are we, really? In 1 Peter chapter 2, Peter describes who we are. He says this, "You are coming to Christ, who is the living cornerstone of God's temple. He was rejected by people, but he was chosen by God for great honor." And here we go. "And you are living stones that God is building into his spiritual temple. What's more," get this, "you are his holy priests. Through the mediation of Jesus Christ, you offer spiritual sacrifices that please God." Peter then talks a little bit about people that discarded Jesus as a cornerstone, but then he goes on. He says, "But you are not like that, for you are a chosen people. You are a royal priest, a holy nation, God's very own possession. As a result," get this, "you can show others the goodness of God, for he called you out of the darkness into his wonderful light." You see, we run into the dark. We refuse to hold back. We show up because of our role. We're priests. In the same way that Aaron was a priest, it is our role to run into the dark. Our mission is to be the light of the world. So how do we do that? If we want to shine, we have to remove the blanket. We have to live out loud, which means doing what Jesus said was vital, the greatest commandment. Love the Lord with all your heart, soul, and mind, and love your neighbor as yourself. We can't just get stuck talking about it. We can't just meet together and head home. We can't create a subculture and avoid the dark. We have to meet it with the goodness of God. Simply put, in Romans 12:21, it says, "Do not be overcome by evil, but overcome evil with good." Paul goes on in 1 Corinthians 13 that you can do a lot of stuff. You can do a lot of things in this life, but without this kind of love, so what? You see, we can know a lot. We can have incredible services. People can have great experiences like speaking in tongues and have a great worship moment. But if we aren't running into the dark to show people love, who cares? It doesn't move the needle. It doesn't accomplish the mission. As exciting as it may feel in the moment, it's empty and hollow because we're called to much more. It requires us to show up and to step out. Probably one of the most powerful memories that I have growing up is when I was younger and living in Houston. We were driving home and my dad saw something that caused us to pull over. On the side of the road, there was a confrontation going on between two people. And one of them was a larger guy. He had, you know, tattoos up his and down his arm, but he also was bleeding from his head because the other guy had a baseball bat and was hammering him, just kept hitting him over and over. We didn't know what the situation was. All we saw was this playing out as cars were driving by and people were standing around. We parked and my dad, without giving even a second thought, jumped out of the car, ran across the street. And I remember seeing him engage in this conflict without, it felt like, any thought at all. He reached over and grabbed the man who was bleeding and put his hand on his head to try to stop the bleeding. And in that moment too, he turned around and looked at the man with the bat. And all I could see, I couldn't hear anything, but I could just see this image of my dad holding this person with blood running down his arm and turning to the other man and saying, "No, no." And that is stuck in my mind for my entire life. Because that is what it means to run into the darkness. That is what it means for us as a church to be running into situations. You see, because I'm sure there was a story going on in that moment. I'm sure there, many people would have looked at this and going, "Man, I wonder what he did." Or like, "Ooh, I wonder what happened. Oh, you know what? He probably did something wrong. He's probably deserving of what's happening in this moment." There were probably a million different ideas of why this was happening and why something he had done had brought this about. But my dad didn't stop in that moment and go, did you do something? Do you deserve to be getting hit in the head with a bat?" No. He ran and he met the need. And that's who we are as a church. That's who we're supposed to be. Because that's what Jesus did for us. And that's who we are called to be. You see, God reaching down through his son into our world was not just this fun play that he was playing out. It wasn't just this weird idea or anything. It was an invitation to each and every one of us that we could be a part again of his plan for our world. He invited us into communion with him and he made a way for it to happen. That's the mission of God. That's the mission that each and every one of us have been called to as well. We can't stand on the sidelines. You see, a lot of times we'll look and go, well, you know, I don't know. Maybe I'm not, I don't feel like I'm geared that way. You are. But sometimes, like I said earlier, we create a false reality that doesn't make any sense, but allows us to hide. But you're called to more. And maybe you're watching this and you're going, I had no idea that God cared about me that much, that he would go so far out of his way to reach me, that his mission was about reaching me. I had no idea. I want you to know how important you are and how valued you are by the maker of the universe, so much so that he sent his son into the darkness to die a horrific death, to take your sin, my sin, the weight of everything that we could have ever done in order to purify us and stop the plague that was killing us. And right now, maybe you're listening to this or you're watching it online. If you're in a place where you can bow your head, I encourage you to do that. If you're listening to this and you're going, I've never imagined anyone caring that much about me, and I want to be a part of what God wants for my life, I invite you to say this prayer with me. Simply in your own words, say this. God, thank you for sending your son. Thank you for valuing me so much that you created a mission where your son reached out, paid the ultimate price, so that I didn't have to live a life that was surrounded in darkness, so that I wouldn't have to live a life surrounded by death, spiritual death and decay, but that I could be a part of something beautiful, that I could be part of your kingdom. God, right now, I accept that sacrifice that was made for me through your son, and I give you the entirety of who I am, knowing that you've called me to that very same mission, to reach others, to care for others, to love others, and I want to embrace that mission as well. Thank you for all that you've done for me, and help me to live my life for you. In Jesus' name, amen. Now, if you made that decision, if you prayed that prayer, I encourage you, first off, what an incredible decision, the most important decision that you will ever make. But I encourage you, connect with us, because this is just the start of your journey. This is the start of your mission. God has saved you so that you in turn can save others and be a part of meeting needs and loving the world around us. So connect with us. We would love to give you resources and tools to continue this journey in Christianity. And maybe some of you who are listening are also battling with this, going, wow, so you really pushed on this whole mission thing of being light in the darkness. What does this mean for me? That's a question I think you need to wrestle with. And I would ask you this. Ask, how are you being light in your family? How are you being a light with your friends? Do you find yourself pulling back from tough situations? Do you find yourself recoiling anytime you face resistance? What would it look like for you to lean in at work, at your school, in different areas, and shine the light of Jesus? I'm not saying that you're hitting people over the head with things, but what would it look like to meet needs, to add, just completely honestly love people the way that Jesus loves you? Wrestle with that. And then let us know what you come up with. Message us and let us know what God spoke to your heart as you've been wrestling with how to be a light in a dark world.
So as Heath was sharing, what came to your mind that God has been calling you to? Maybe it's that thing that you've been avoiding because it involves some uncertainty, or you just can't really see all the steps ahead of you, but you know that He's called you to it. But you know what? If He's called you to it, He will be faithful to lead you through it, even though it can be scary. Over the years working in youth ministry, I've gotten the privilege of seeing so many students go through high school and graduate and go on to college ministry and the next steps of their life. And I've gotten to walk with so many young people who have said yes to God's call, whether that be to go to college or even to step into ministry, heading into the unknown, even when it's frightening and they don't really know what their next steps are like. I've gotten to watch the testimony as God has seen them through time and time again, and really just paved the way for them to step into calling and purpose. And you know, one of the things that God has called our church into is actually starting up Heart College, the purpose being to equip young people for ministry. So go ahead and check this out.
This last year, Heart College was relaunched and 9 new students joined our leadership and degree seeking programs. These students are driven by a passion for ministry, serving the church, and leadership development. A couple of students had the opportunity to preach for the first time, interact with pastors, and make progress toward their degrees through our partnership with an accredited university. At Heart College, students participate in staff meetings, leadership development labs, and hands-on practical experiences. Additionally, a sense of community has been fostered through church activities, family nights, and other team outings. Here's what some of them had to say.
My favorite part of Heart College has been getting to understand the different parts of ministry. I didn't realize how many there were, and getting to understand what they get to do on a day-to-day basis and use their job to glorify God.
We sit down with youth pastors, sit down with senior pastors. I had that opportunity to just sit down with them and just be able to communicate with them. They treated us as if we were a part of staff.
I've learned that failure is okay and to not be afraid of it, or else I'm going to miss out on opportunity that I didn't know I had.
Something I've learned is just to be patient, trusting God and His timing and His plans for your life.
Anyone who's looking to see how ministry works, how a church works, or just anything about ministry, I recommend Howard College because they give you a nice view on it.
We are excited about the future of these students and are inviting new ones to sign up for the upcoming semester. Thank you for your generosity, family. The next generation is worth it, and the next generation is on fire for the Lord. Will you keep these leaders in your prayers for the fall and pray that new students will respond to their call?
Were those testimonies amazing? Listen, we cannot do amazing things like Heart College without God's faithfulness and the faithfulness and generosity of our congregation. So if you feel so called to give, you can do so at pureheart.org/give. And listen, if you want to keep up with all of the latest things happening here at Pure Heart, you can follow us on social media, and you can also check out our podcast where we have amazing interviews. We talk about the things that are happening within our church body. So you guys don't want to miss it. You can find it on every streaming platform, and you can even find the video content on YouTube. We love you guys. And listen, if you were impacted by today's video, I want to encourage you, give this video a like so it can show up on other people's feed. Share it with a friend who you know would also be encouraged by it. And make sure you subscribe so you don't miss any of our new videos coming up. We love you guys, and we'll see you next week.